Good evening. My name is John Jessup, and I'm the president of the Student Philanthropy Council here at DePauw. I'm pleased to welcome you to tonight's virtual alumni college lecture, and I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker. Professor Martha Rainbolt taught at DePauw from 1979 to 2008 in the English department. During her time here, Professor Rainbolt was known as an outstanding professor and received the Frederick C. Tucker Distinguished Career Award in 1998. She also served as the chair of the English department and director of the Honor Scholar Program. Professor Rainbolt played a vital role in the shaping of the Janet Prindle Institute for Ethics. She served as the chair for the Prindle Institute Advisory Committee and coordinator of the Undergraduate Ethics Symposium. To continue, she is also a founding member of the Women's Studies Program at DePauw. On behalf of the Office of Alumni Engagement, I welcome Professor Martha Rainbolt to tonight's virtual alumni college to speak on Katniss Everdeen's emerging moral consciousness in the Hunger Games. Professor Rainbolt will make some introductory remarks and then take questions from attendees here in Watson Forum, and from those watching online. If you're preparing via or participating via webinar, please use the link that was sent in the email to submit questions. As president of the Student Philanthropy Council, I want to thank all of you for your gifts to the Fund for DePauw, which helped DePauw make great professors like Dr. Rainbolt. Without further delay, I'd like to welcome Dr. Rainbolt to the stage.
Thanks, John. Thank you. Hi, it's good to be here. And I appreciate that really nice introduction. Thank you for that. I'm going to talk with you tonight about the Hunger Games, both the film and the book. And I'm really interested in the juxtaposition of the two and the ways in which they connect. The film, I think, is really good. And I think I should say that right off the bat. I think it's a good film. I think it does a lot of very interesting things. And if we have time, after I've talked more about the novel in this sort of prepared talk I have, we'll talk more about the film. But I have one really serious problem with the film, and that's what I want to focus on today. When film critics said they didn't like the film, they talked about what seemed to me to be sort of silly things. Like they said there wasn't enough violence in the Hunger Games, you know, that the violence was muted, it should have been more violent. And they didn't like Jennifer Lawrence. And how can you not like Jennifer Lawrence, you know? She's such a terrific actress. But I understand she's too sort of fit looking, you know, she really looks like she's been well fed. And Katniss Everdeen, as we know from the novel, is not well fed. But the problem with the book for me is that the director Gary Ross and the writers mute some of the serious ethical implications present in the novel. One major motif dealing with the ethical implications of violence and survival of the fittest is totally ignored, I think, in the film version. It's really crucial in the novel, and it's bookended by two crucial scenes, PETA's early statement of his moral code and the scene centered on the attack by the mutations late in the novel. By the way, on your handout, mutations is corrected. It shouldn't be spelled with one T. She deliberately spells it M-U-T-T-A-T-I-O-N because it's about the mutts. It's about those hound-like creatures that attack Katniss and PETA at the end of the book. So they are mutations, not mutations. I think this scene and the scene about the mutations and the scene on the roof in the hotel are crucial to understanding the emergent moral consciousness of Katniss. The central question, I think, of the first book of the Hunger Games trilogy is not, will Katniss survive? I mean, it's a novel. She's going to make it. She's the protagonist. We know she's going to get through it. The question is, how will she survive? Will she be reduced to a dog-eat-dog kind of creed, or will she come home true to the values she reveals to us in the self-sacrificing scene where she volunteers to take her younger sister's place in the Hunger Games. When the Capitol planned the 74th Hunger Game to punish the districts for their rebellion, it intended not only to force the people of the districts to watch their children kill other children and eventually die themselves, but also to turn those children into mutations after their death. Monsters whose only desire is to attack the remaining living tributes. PETA understands the games, and he expresses his fear to Katniss early in the novel. You have on your handout as number two the text of this conversation between PETA and Katniss. He stammers as he says, "I don't want to disgrace myself." And a few lines later, he says, "I want to die as myself. I don't want them to change me in there, turn me into some kind of monster that I'm not." Later on, he says, "I keep wishing I could think of a way to show the Capitol they don't own me, that I'm more than just a piece in their games." Katniss replies that she doesn't understand either point. "Who cares?" is her response to PETA. She comments that she only cares about staying alive, and she ridicules PETA for planning some noble death. Katniss, early in the novel, articulates her desire to stay alive any way she can and to deny the heroic code articulated by PETA. Now let's look at the film's version of that same scene and see what the film did with this episode. This is the night before the Hunger Games begin, when they're in the hotel, do you remember? And she, of course, can't sleep and goes up on the roof. Whoops, we don't have any sound. They've just been through all that incredible training, and they're trying to face the next morning and all that it's going to mean to them. But we still don't have any sound. Okay, so what they do is they leave out absolutely all the references to the monsters. The business about turning them into monsters. They leave out her kind of dismissal of what he says, and we'll come back to it if we can. When he says, "I want to die as myself," she says, "I can't afford that. I have my sister." So what the screenwriter has done is connect it back to Prim. And I think that's beautiful. I like that. But I don't see why it has to negate all of the other kind of things that Collins originally put in. But the thing that bothers me most is totally leaving out this turning me into a monster, making me someone who is not myself. That seems to me has to be here in this to make this story really work. And that's what they have eliminated in the film version. From the beginning of the novel, Collins presents Katniss as a character who is intent not simply on staying alive, right? I mean, you remember all those scenes in the early part of the book when, first of all, she disobeys the law to go hunting for the food for her family. She can't do that. That's, she could be killed for that, but she does that. She, of course, volunteers to be in the Hunger Games to protect her sister. If you've read the novel, you remember that when she's out in the woods with Gale, and she sees the girl and boy running away and the hovercraft coming to capture them, she doesn't do anything to help. And she feels terrible because she knows they were trying to get away. And later on, she sees that same girl as the AVOX in the Capitol. She's waiting on her. Remember, they've cut her tongue out so that she can't talk. And that's the punishment. If you try to escape, you get your tongue cut out. These things are left out in the movie, and that, I think, is a real shame. It shows the incredible brutality of the Capitol. Katniss has a strong moral core from the very beginning. I'm not arguing that. What it is that she's not conscious of it. She's doing it somehow intuitively, but she can't explain it even to herself. And what happens in the novel is she becomes able to explain that to herself. This, I think, is shown by her remarkably naive response to PETA when she's, quote, "I shake my head, how could he die as anyone but himself?" I mean, that sounds really, really naive. So PETA is Katniss's mentor, in a way, in the early part of the book, I think. She has this strong moral code that's similar to his, but she doesn't understand that aspect of herself. And the trajectory of the novel is one which begins with Katniss acting altruistically but speaking egocentrically. And as we move through, we see her gain self-knowledge that she can affirm that same values and moral code that PETA uses. So I argue that Katniss learns all of this, and at the very end of the book, she even goes beyond where PETA is. In the final episode, her moral fiber is even stronger than PETA's, and she earns her place as the moral center for the revolution against the Capitol in the scene with the poison berries. But let's go back and look at some of the earlier stuff and how this sort of trajectory goes, the rhetorical shape of the narrative, as we see Katniss developing this self-knowledge. Collins has to manage the difficult question of how to have Katniss be violent when she is such a good person. I mean, she kills people in the novel, right? She kills the fire starter. She thinks about killing the fire starter. And she kills the boy who kills Rue, you remember? And she kills Glimmer with the tracker jacket scene. She seems even callous sometimes, it seems to me. When she's talking about the fire starter, she says, "I won't have the least problem taking out my new neighbor. My instinct has been to flee, not fight. But obvious, this person is a hazard. Stupid people are dangerous. And this one probably doesn't have much in the way of weapons, while I've got this excellent knife." I mean, here's she calling a possible victim as stupid, calculating the value of any supplies the fire starter might have. So we have a complex character, I think, in Katniss Everdeen. Collins distances her protagonist from the professional killers of Districts 1 and 2. You remember, they're exuberant when they kill someone. They cheer and they say, okay, three down, 21 more to go, or whatever. They love killing. She's never like that. But she isn't a goody-two-shoes. She's not a sentimental, two-dimensional person. She almost always does the right thing. But she's often confused about why she does it and about her own motivations. At times she seems naive. Sometimes she becomes sort of pragmatic and it's all about staying alive. Sometimes she just wants to go home. But we see this really forthright young girl faced with a series of devastating decisions and not really able to think them through clearly. Katniss rarely kills the other tributes, and Collins even distances the reader from Katniss's consciousness in the killing scene. She moves us away from Katniss actually killing someone. I think the best example of that is in the scene where she kills the boy from District 1 who killed Rue. The killing occurs between two chapters of the novel. We see Rue, we see the spear entering Rue's body, and then the next chapter starts with Katniss's arrow in the neck of the boy from District 1. And later on in this scene, Collins brings back Peeta's earlier words, the ones we just talked about, but now Katniss is speaking them. I'm quoting here, "Then I remember Peeta's words on the roof, only I keep wishing I could think of a way to show the capital they don't own me, that I'm more than just a piece in their games. For the first time, I understand what he means." So her reaction to the killing of the boy from District 1, even though she felt she had to do it, he had just killed Rue, is her worrying about, am I becoming a murderer? Am I becoming someone who kills? And what does that mean? So I think this is a moment when she's moving toward an important kind of self-knowledge and an articulation of her moral code. She's determined to show that Rue and she are more than a piece in the games. And you remember that that's when she gathers the flowers and surrounds Rue with them, really, and looking very beautiful. And then as she leaves, she gives her the three-finger salute, which is the statement of admiration and solidarity, the same salute that she was given at the reaping when she volunteered to take her sister's place. So, but Katniss, she's moved a long way at this point in the novel, but she's not there yet, because she walks away thinking, quote, "I'd kill anyone I met on sight without emotion or the slightest tremor in my hands. My hatred of the capital has not lessened my hatred of my competitors in the least, especially the careers. They at least can be made to pay for Rue's death." So she, in some sense, I think here, even though she's come a long way, she's still playing their game, or at least she thinks she is. But in the course of the novel, she never kills a tribute simply for revenge or simply to eliminate another player. When she runs into some, you remember in the movie even, when she runs into the other girl early on, they both just dash off in different directions. She kills in self-defense, and finally, late in the novel, she kills Cato to end his suffering because he begs her to do so when the Mutations are mauling him. But after his death, there's no jubilation from either Katniss or Peeta. Peeta says, "We won," with a hollow voice, and Katniss feels, quote, "no joy of victory." In part three of the novel, Collins continues to trace Katniss's developing moral consciousness in terms of her attitudes towards killings and potential killings. When Clove is ready to kill her at the cornucopia at the very end of the novel, Katniss vows she will die undefeated. It is not just staying alive that's important. Death with dignity, as she says, and defiance. Those are the two words she uses. I want my death to be with dignity and defiance. That's a priority. When Peeta and she realize that only Foxface, Cato, and Thresh are left, and Peeta says he hopes Cato will kill Thresh, Katniss again removes herself from the conventional player of the game by thinking, I don't want Cato to kill Thresh at all. I don't want anyone else to die. But this is absolutely not the kind of thing that victors go around saying in the arena, unquote. Katniss is becoming more and more assertive that she's not a mere pawn in their game, and she's also gaining more confidence in her integrity. So we see this development throughout the novel, but it is right at the end of the book where we finally see her cast aside her naivete and find the moral center for which she's been searching. The choices presented to the tributes by the Capitol are stark. Either survive by murdering other children or die screaming in fear. Either way, the tribute is merely a piece of the game. How can any tribute exhibit dignity in the face of the incredible power of the Capitol, the power to destroy not only the tributes, but also their families, their friends, even their districts? You know that she's often thinking about this. What will they do to my mom and to Prim if I don't do what they want me to? You know, there's that threat that's always on top of her. The Capitol's objectives with the tributes are twofold, each of which embodies PETA's worst fears: to remove their individuality and turn them into monsters for all Paynim to see, their individuality and their humanity, and to make them tributes, to make all the tributes just a part of the game. The climactic scene occurs when Katniss recognizes that the mutations are reincarnations of the tributes. Collins describes the mutations in this way from Katniss's perspective, and this is the third part of your handout. The green eyes glowering at me are unlike any dog or wolf, any canine I've ever seen. They are unmistakably human, and that revelation has barely registered when I notice the collar with number one inlaid with jewels, and the whole horrible thing hits me. The blonde hair, the green eyes, the number, its glimmer. And worst of all, the smallest mutt with dark glossy fur, huge brown eyes, and a collar that reads 11 in woven straw, teeth bared in hatred, Rue. When Rue dies, Katniss describes her as, quote, smaller than ever, a baby animal curled up in a nest of netting, unquote. Rue personified the innocence of youth and the fragility of children. After her death, she is reincarnated by the Capitol into a mutation, a vicious monster, a cross between a wolf and a coyote, but it is Rue's eyes, Rue's coloring. Okay, let's look at what the film does with the mutations. You think it'll go this time? This is the game room where the game masters are making the mutations. And this is PETA. You still don't have any sound. Where they go, and they're climbing up the cornucopia, and there are just the three of them left: Katniss, PETA, and Cato. All the rest are dead. And Cato gets a hold of PETA. Okay, get the... She shoots the she shoots Cato's hand, and PETA falls forward, and Cato goes down to the mutts. He's taunting her. Obviously, he thinks he's going to win now. Cato thinks he's going to win. He's from District 1. He's the careerist. He's the one of the ones who has trained all his life to be in the Hunger Games. And of course, she's such a terrific marksman with her bow and arrow that she's able to hear it. And now he's down there being mauled by those creatures. Okay, so that you can see, sorry about this problem, but you can see that the computer-generated mutations are just simply ugly, ferocious creatures. I mean, the scene in which Katniss, Peeta, and Cato are attacked by the mutations running through the woods, it's a reprise of many early films where humans are attacked by wolf-like figures. In this regard, it seems the Hunger Games seems to be copying scenes used in movies from The Lord of the Rings to The Grey. And Ross even uses a somewhat standard version from among early film treatments. So in the novel, however, it's really different. Peeta's worst fears are realized. Glimmer, Rue, and all the other dead tributes are transformed into the mutations and are pieces in the game. These creatures die, they kill, and then die as humans, but they are reincarnated as monsters who will kill again and again and again. Certainly the Rue whom Katniss and we as readers loved is no longer herself. She is merely a pawn of the game master, and her family and friends in District 11 have to watch the little girl they loved transformed into this vicious ancient agent of death. So at the end of the scene, it looks like the capital has won. Maybe Katniss and Peeta will survive, but all the contestants have lost their individuality. They've succumbed to the capital's perverse moral code. But in the next episode, Colin surprises the reader. Katniss, ironically, is able to turn the rules of the game back upon the capital so that both she and Peeta are the victors. Katniss knows the capital has to have a winner. People would be outraged if they both should die. So in their refusal to fight each other and their willingness to die by eating the poison berries rather than continue the carnage, the couple gains control over the organizers of the game. We as readers realize that Katniss has moved to a position of moral strength, even in regard to Peeta. Throughout the novel, Collins brought the reader into the heart of Katniss's dilemmas, and it was this tension, I think, which made Katniss the more interesting character than Peeta, who is admirable but rather two-dimensional, I would argue. We know he will always do the right thing for the right reasons. At the end of the games, when the Capitol changed the rules and decided there could be only one winner, Peeta threw away his knife and insisted that Katniss shoot him. She had drawn her bow and faced him, stopping only when he threw away his knife. However, when Peeta said, "We both know they have to have a victor," Katniss moves beyond Peeta and takes the lead. She realizes she can turn the Capitol's game against it. Peeta was willing to martyr himself, but Katniss is the leader of the moral revolution to come. She doesn't play by their rules. Instead, she turns their rules against them and forces the capital to let them both live. She isn't a martyr. She's a winner of the game whose rules she adapted to her moral code. And as we discover in the next few pages, I'm afraid it's a fleeting victory because we have two more books to read. But they have won on their own terms. They remain true to themselves and each other, and they are more than just pieces in the capital's grisly games. Katniss is the one who takes the lead in their willingness to risk suicide together rather than to fight each other to the death. She calculates, however, that they aren't really committing suicide since they know the capital has to have a winner. So Katniss has a self-knowledge at the end of the book which she didn't have earlier. She's acted morally through most of the novel, but she's only gradually acquired the ability to articulate to herself the moral code at the base of those actions. Perhaps recognizing the extent of the capital's depravity in its conception of the Hunger Games, Katniss realized the lengths to which it will go to provide entertainment for the people of the capital, involving mesmerizing scenes of terror for the people of Districts 1 to 12. For whatever reason, the director of the film version of Hunger Games softened the edges of those final scenes by not revealing that the mutations were really bestial versions of the dead tributes. This change diminishes, the significance of Katniss and PETA's victory. To become a piece of the Capitol's games in the novel's terms is literally to become a murdering monster. But in the film's terms, the stakes are lower. It's terrible to kill, even to lose your life in the arena, but it's even worse, as described in the novel, to become a mutation, a killing machine totally controlled by the Capitol. Why did this film settle for this muted version of the power struggle? As we all know, cinema can use visual images in powerful ways to create and interpret and reinforce a film's themes. What if the mutation scene had included a shot at Katniss looking into the eyes of one of the monsters who was trying to tear her apart, and then suddenly realize she was looking into the huge brown eyes of Rue? Okay. Thank you all. All right, so what questions do you have about this? Do you have any questions for me about this, or about the Hunger Games in general, or what sorts of?
We have a few questions online. Several questions about the relationship between Katniss and Peeta and Gale. First one is from Susan Wadsworth Booth.
Hey, hi, Susan.
Engaging her tonight, so she asked a couple questions. When I read The Hunger Games...
She's a former student of mine. It was just nice to hear from her. Right. Sorry, guys.
When I read The Hunger Games books with my daughters, who were then in early high school and upper middle school, I was pleased to see that the love triangle aspect wasn't really a main part of the story, but a side aspect, somewhat played up in the movies. But as I thought about the topic of your talk, it occurred to me that the rising moral consciousness is mirrored by Katniss' relationships with these two young men as well. Do you agree? Her feelings for PETA and also for Gale are a direct result, as they develop, of her attitudes toward others in general and her attitude toward being self-sacrificial for the common good, it seems to me. What are your thoughts? And then I'll come back to her second question after you answer that one.
Ooh, yeah. Well, first of all, Susan, I really agree that the romance in this, the romantic triangle supposedly in this novel is a very much a secondary part of the book. It's not really what it's about. And I think that's a good thing. I think that the star-crossed lovers thing works well and narratively, and works out so that they can have this great scene at the end of the book. But this is Katniss's story, and she's the character that we're thinking most about. I think that the idea that both Gale and Peeta, let me start with both Gale and Peeta are mentors in a way. I mean, Gale is older. He teaches her how to hunt. She knows how to do it with a bow and arrow, but he teaches her about the snares and all those kinds of things. And when you may recall the scene when she's leaving and he says to her, "You can do this, you can kill. You're the best hunter I know." And she says, "People," and that's different. And then later on she thinks, "But what if it isn't different?" And she gets frightened. I mean, so Gale is like PETA, and I think that's what Susan's getting at here. He serves as a catalyst for this development that she's going through, that she remembers things he said to her, and they help her to develop her own sort of person. The great thing about both of these men, boys, whichever we're to call them, is that they don't, either of them, dominate her or try to, they're both in many ways equal to her. They see themselves as equal. There isn't a male-female kind of thing going on with either PETA and Katniss, or with Gail and Katniss. So I think the men are quite the boys. They see they're boys. They don't look like boys in the movie, but they are in the book. They're boys. This is children fighting children. That's sort of what the Hunger Games is about. I think that they're really. I think that they really do have an equality with her, which is very important in her development.
Okay. One more question from Susan. I think you'll like this one, and then I'll open it up to others here in the live audience as well, although we've had a few more questions come in from our online crowd. But Susan's second quick question is, also, since I always remember your, quote, "I'd rather be reading Jane Austen," end quote, sticker on your door, are there any ways in which Katniss reminds you of any Austen heroines?
Emma is always a good person, but she doesn't do the right things, and she messes up big time. And she figures it all out, and I think she's the closest. But there's always a Jane Austen character. And what do you think, Claudia? Is there a or Andrea or any of you? Do you have a Jane Austen character in mind? You thought of Emma? Yeah. It's very different because Emma is so comfortable. Whatever Katniss is in this novel, she's never comfortable. Yeah. Right. Any other questions?
Oh, Carl.
Yeah, my question just sort of follows on what you've been talking about, but you suggest that PETA is Katniss's mentor early on in his ethical view of the world, that he doesn't want to become an animal, right? And she doesn't understand this. But then by the end, you suggest that she's caught up with him and maybe even surpassed him. Is that so? What's happened to PETA then? Is he is he fallen behind here? What has she learned that he doesn't know now? Or is that a way of thinking about it?
Yeah. Well, the thing that they share, of course, is the self-sacrifice. That she sacrificed herself for her sister, and he, throughout the Hunger Games, is sacrificing himself for her. I mean, he's consciously doing that, and so I think that they are very similar, and I think he's really crucial to her. I mean, I don't think she could have gotten where she gets without him. I guess. Dare I say she's just smarter than he is? I mean, she figures out how to turn things back on the Capitol. He's continuing to be self-sacrificial at the end when he throws down the knife and says, "Go ahead and shoot me. You've got to shoot me now because they have to have a victor." But she figures out how to go beyond that. What I'm worried about is, why is that? I think that's smarts. That's a kind of strategic cleverness and like that, too. I mean, it had to happen in a split second. She had to figure all this out very fast. But you've got me sort of stuck, because why is that morally superior? Is it morally superior to be smart? Probably not necessarily. To be, I'm not sure I have really, you may have hit on something here that I need to think about more fully. Does anybody have any idea on that? Do you buy my argument that she's gone a step beyond him in a moral sense rather than just an intellectual sense? Yeah.
Well, maybe just a different look at it. It seemed to me that Katniss was a reluctant participant in the games at the beginning, even though she volunteered to take her sister's place. And that as it went on, she became a more enthusiastic participant. Now, I may be wrong about that, but that's just kind of the impression that I had. And maybe if that's true, however, her increased enthusiasm was a function of the fact that she just outsmarted the operation. And if that's all, I'd be curious to know if you agree with that, and if so, what does that say about her moral and ethical position and development?
She's enthusiastic. I guess I don't quite, in what sense is she more enthusiastic? She's more confident? Is that what?
More confident?
Because she's so frightened at first.
She's so frightened, but I think she decides, she figures out she can win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I think she, well, I guess I wouldn't call her enthusiastic. I mean, I think she always hates the killing, and she, there's this another scene where she's thinking about Thresh dying, Cato killing Thresh, and she says it's murder. And she said she uses the word murder. She said we're murdering each other. I mean, I think that she finds it I think she finds it repulsive, but I agree with you that she gets confident, and she also then turns it into a challenge. She sees it's something that she can conquer, and she's going to do, you know, she's always doing it. She says she's doing it for Prim, and then she's doing it for Rue. I mean, she has all these people supporting her, but she has a kind of confidence and a, there is almost an eagerness, maybe, to take the challenge that's being put in front of her. But not enthusiasm, to me, implies that she somehow condones it. And I don't think she ever condones what's going on in any way. But her attitude toward it changes, I think.
Another question from an online viewer, Liz Strabel, class of 07, I think from New York City, writes, amazing to see and hear you, Professor Rainbolt. Thank you for this lecture. Beyond Katniss, I feel like the movie lets the audience off the hook and doesn't address societal morality as it applies to systemic classism. My question, overall, do you feel like the movie drops ways in which the book deals with political commentary? In the book, Katniss receives her Mockingjay pin, the good luck charm, from the daughter of the district's mayor. I viewed it as a symbol that luck does not really exist, that it is all about connections and power, especially in a world where odds are not ever in their favor. The movie makes a change. Katniss gets the pin from a poor neighbor in her district's black market. My case is that this change undermines the world that Suzanne Collins built, that highlights real-world implications of systemic classism. But I cling to my metaphors. What do you think?
Well, I mean, the other part of the book, which I don't go into at all here, and I'd love to, but when we talk about it in class, is the political. Suzanne Collins wrote this as a critique of our society. She said in an interview that the idea for the book came to her when she was flipping through TV channels and she was watching a report on the war in Iraq, and then she flipped over to reality television and she saw those two together and she thought, I'm going to write about the Hunger Games. And when you look at a map of the USA, and you see that District 12 is West Virginia, and District 1 is Denver, Colorado. The capital is Denver, Colorado, and you can see people have laid it out on a map, and it mirrors exactly the sort of wealthier and more poverty kinds of situations that we have in this country, and I don't think that's happenstance. I think Collins really is writing about the haves and the have-nots in a very, very serious way, And she's, I think the Mockingjay example is a really good one, the Mockingjay pin. Again, though, the movie ties it to Prim, because she gives it to Prim, and then Prim gives it to her. So there's this, the movie's really making a big whatever with the connection to Prim, which I understand. I think it works. But I think that's a really interesting point about, you know, where she got it originally in each of the sources. Yeah, I mean, she really sees the U.S. as dividing into haves and have-nots in a serious way, and this novel is a critique of that. And you could go through and do a paper or, you know, whatever, a whole talk the way I did, just on those kinds of parallels between the world of the capital and the districts and the USA now. I think it'd be really easy to do.
One.
Yeah.
Just going back to the beginning of the novel where Katniss is in District 12 before the reaping,
yeah,
and how I wanted to know your take on how you think that her matronly being a matronly figure to Prim because of her father passing away and her
right.
mother's distress, and if that you think that that is a crucial point before the reaping that causes Katniss's development throughout the whole book. Like if that's a distinguishing point or characteristic that maybe has her thinking that she is, because she's a matronly figure to Prim, that she's steadfastly in her moral values, but like you said, doesn't realize it, or if it's different.
Hmm. Is it the nurturing kind of, is that with the matronly?
The nurturing and also being the head of household and
right.
being the provider, and if that
Mm-hmm.
kind of.
Yeah, yeah. Well, see, that's another way in which I see her and Gale as really parallel figures, because he and she are both the providers. You know, I mean, he's doing it for his family just as she's doing it for hers, and his father died and he's had to take over. And I think there's a nice kind of gender bending going on here, or gender merging or something. And so I wouldn't want to call it matronly so much as nurturing, and sort of I mean, for her it she does have to replace her mother, but she also has to replace her father in terms of providing. She has to give both the physical affection and all of that to Prim, and also the rabbits and the cat, the cat, the vegetables and everything. So but do you see it as more, is there something I'm missing here in terms of a more female thing with that? Do you see her being different from Gale in this way?
Maybe not necessarily when her and Gale are together in scenes, like when they're out past District 12 and they're by themselves. But when, especially in the movie, how it portrays when they're getting ready for the reaping and Katniss turns to her mother and says that she has to be strong, and after the reaping too, to where she tells her mother, like, you have to be Prim's mother again. And
mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Right.
Personally, I took that as her being very strong and determinant going into the games, and then hearing your talk and how you argue that she wasn't really morally conscious at the beginning and then became morally conscious throughout the book, I just thought that was an interesting take on it, because it was different from what I thought.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I do. We certainly do see her very much in that role, and that's, and when she just yells at her mother, you know, you can't go away again, and we don't see all that with Gale. We only hear about that indirectly. But both Gale and PETA, I mean, PETA gives her the bread. I mean, that these guys are both very kind of nurturing sort of people, and that's a good thing in the book.
Another question on the relationships. I think it's a slightly different twist, from Neil McKinney, class of 09. I'd like to know your thoughts on Katniss' moral consciousness as it relates to her relationships between PETA and Gale in terms of her misunderstanding of their love for her. I felt Collins writes Katniss very naively in this way, particularly when PETA or Gale are upset with her for being affectionate with the other. and Katniss does not seem to understand why, which seems to sell her consciousness short. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah. Does anybody remember? How old is she? Yeah. I mean, I think part of our problem here is that we associate her with Jennifer Lawrence. I mean, I think of her as being really, what, do you know?
16. That's what I was, oh. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, then why, yeah. Yeah. It's, you know, I don't know, but it doesn't feel like a problem for me that she's not aware of those things. She, at the beginning of the book, in some sense, she really is trying to stay alive. She is about staying alive. I mean, she is a really pragmatic sort of, how do you get it done? How do you get from Monday to Friday sort of person, especially before the reaping and in the, and she really takes that same kind of, you know, it's right in front of me, I got to do this, and then we'll think about what I have to do next later. But right now I have to. She's really not thinking about love relationships. She's more comfortable with Gale. And at one point she makes the point that she doesn't want to think about it. She keeps telling herself, I don't want to think about it that way. I want him to be my friend. I want to have a companion, but I don't want to get into all that complicated stuff. Seems to me she's very, I like that about her, but, and maybe most 16-year-olds aren't like that, but I think there probably are some whose lives are just not really ready for all that romance and crushes and all that mean, and they'd really rather, especially if you're living in that world she's in, where just getting from Monday to Friday is quite an ordeal without getting shot or something.
Another interesting question online, Rachel Hannabut, class of 2015. Dr. Rainbolt, some have likened some aspects of the Hunger Games to a reflection of modern-day society. While I agree with your interpretation that Katniss' morality emerges throughout the book, some might contend that her blatant disregard for the rules of society is immoral because she, like modern-day Edward Snowden, is not abiding by the rules decided on by those in power. How would your reading of Katniss as a moral character change if she and her story were not supported by the impoverished districts?
Not supported by the impoverished district. You mean if she wasn't a member, or if she wasn't, I'm just trying to think exactly what the...
I think she's saying if Katniss were not a hero or a representation of the class conflict that we were discussing earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If she were not standing up for the oppressed people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I've alluded to it quickly in my talk. I think she's a complicated character, and I think she's always trying to make distinctions. When there's another scene early in the book, or maybe it's when she's thinking back to it with Gale, when she kills a deer, and after she kills the deer, she says, but it was so pure and innocent, so beautiful. And there's this sense that she feels she shouldn't have killed it. I mean, she's always drawing distinctions that are really quite subtle. And I don't think she breaks any laws that are not unjust. I think that, you know, in Martin Luther King's description of the difference between just and unjust laws, that the just laws uplift and unjust laws oppress. That I think that the laws she's breaking are unjust, and his argument is that you have a moral obligation to violate unjust laws. I mean, there are problems with that, but I guess I think I see her as in that tradition, and so I applaud what she does, whether or not she's representative of District 12 or whatever. I still would applaud her breaking those unjust laws in order to help people out, which is what, she doesn't do it for herself, she's always doing it for someone else. She's breaking the laws to feed her family or to save her sister, or, you know, she's not doing it for the new turquoise bracelet she wants or something.
Well, with that, Dr. Rainbolt, I want to thank you on behalf of our alumni who've tuned in online, as well as members of our community here in Watson Forum. Much like your classrooms in Asbury Hall, we had a thought-provoking discussion tonight, and we're all grateful for that and all that you continue to do for our alumni and for the university. So thank you so much.
Oh, it's great. I enjoyed it. Thank you. It was fun.